Watercolour textures, that's what this video is all about. I'm going to show you 10 different ways of creating realistic texture within your watercolour paintings. Thank you very much for joining me here on YouTube. Now, I'm Paul Hopkinson, a wildlife artist, and I love sharing my watercolour techniques through my online tutorials, so welcome to my channel. I'll show you the texture within an actual painting, and we'll talk about the watercolour techniques to use, and also some tips and tricks to getting each one to look realistic. If the video goes well and feedback in the comments is really good, I may produce future videos which will go into even more detail on specific textures. So let me know if this is something you'll be interested in. But for now, let's get going with the first texture, shiny metal, and dip our toe into the most important things to think about when painting metal in watercolour. Now, what I try to look for when I'm painting metal is that I look at the light, so the light and the shine that you see to create the form of, well, especially these rings as well, because you can see it's actually dark on one side and light on the other side. So by allowing these light areas to show through, that'll give you the shape and the feel that this is actually metal, and that's what we want to do. But we're also looking at the colours we use within the metal as well. So I'm looking at adding yellows and blues and blacks and browns sometimes, but very often these colours tend to reflect what's around them as well within the metal, don't they? So it's a bit like a mirror really, especially if it's really shiny metal like chrome, something that's chrome plated like this. So your lines need to be quite smooth when you're working on this, so try and maintain a very smooth, even kind of line. Now, I tend to practice this a little bit by kind of ghosting with my hand. So the idea is you kind of work out roughly where you want it to go, then using hardly any pressure, you apply that line, lifting off at the very end. Okay, so when you do all that, then we're gonna add a little bit of watercolor white, just kind of bring out the extra sparkle over the top, just kind of finish off this piece of metal. And you can see by concentrating both the light and the dark areas and adding a little bit of light spot on the top, then we'll finally get a realistic feel for hard, shiny looking metal. Our second texture is rusty metal, which is really useful in paintings with those oldie, worldy objects. It's all about building layer upon layer of similar detail by looking at the kind of contrast from the light all the way through to the dark. So we're gradually getting darker as we go along. So I'm going to use within this is going to be wetting wet techniques, and we're going to use dry technique as well over the top by applying the colour in both dots and also stippling over the top of that. But we do stippling, we do scumbling, and all sorts of way of creating textures. You know, there's a lot of brushes that we all have in our arsenal within our brush kits, where we've got very old, really detailed brushes, or very old brushes which are not much use now, are they? Save them, because these are very handy for this sort of effect, as you can see. See, once this layer is dry, then all I need to do is go over the top of that layer, then add yet another layer over the top of that. Because remember, watercolour naturally dries lighter as it goes drier, doesn't it, as it starts to dry. Obviously depends on the amount of pigment that you've got within the paint. But then eventually what we tend to finish off is the darkest layer over the top. And by doing so, that's going to give the overall contrast and shape and that kind of rusty feel, which is what we're looking for within this kind of old metal feel. So it's well worth having a look around where you live. Find some old rust, some old locks or anything like that which you can photograph, and give something like this a try. So once you finish this, add a little bit of watercolour white just to kind of top it off. If you're finding these texture painting techniques useful, please could you do me a really big favour and click on that thumbs up button. This simple action can help more people see my video and enable my little channel to grow. Now we're moving away from metal and onto stones for our third watercolour texture. Now when you look at a pile like this of stones, it's really about defining each one individually and making them all look slightly different to one another, so it's not all looking the same all the way through. So you need to do what I'm doing here, just slightly outline and kind of work out, map out the area first of all. Kind of roughly work out, I don't know, roughly where you might want these stones to be. And remember to vary the shapes and vary the sizes as you go along as well. Then you can start to fill those in by using a wet in wet wash, scumbling techniques, dry brush techniques yet again, so we can do all sorts of techniques on top of these stones and vary those colours at the same time. So really it's almost like about the in-between sections really, that are about the stones themselves. So we're looking at the dark shadows in between each stone that we can see. That's going to make up the overall shape of each individual stone and make them all stand out. So vary the lightness, vary the darkness as you go along, and as I say, vary those colours. But when you work on top of these, also vary the size of the brush you're going to work with as well. And I tend to use very often a size 00, but sometimes I'll switch to a size 1 or even a size 5. I know, but it depends on the amount of detail you want to apply. Another way you can do this as well is by using a little bit of masking fluid just before you start putting the washes on, and that will reserve some of the whites of the paper to kind of make them stand out. Now, what we tend to do as well, if you want to try and get those really bright highlights on there, we can use a little bit of watercolour white over the top, or white gouache, whichever you kind of prefer to use, or which you've got within your painting kit. But apply this to where the light is hitting the stones. Give it a go and let me know how you get on. Check out that card to the top right if you'd like to see how I painted the little mouse's bright shiny eyes. Not all stones are rough like this though, so you find that many on a beach or areas like that are beautifully round, aren't they? So they're really round and glossy and smooth. So texture number 4 is all about a smooth, round pebble. So with a round, smooth object, it's about the subtle kind of tonal differences you can see, but in a pebble like these, you really need to apply in small stipples, scumble marks to make the pebbles look real. We see what you will do then after that is by using a very light wash of just clean water, as daft as it sounds, just very clean water, no paint, nothing like that. Just kind of soften down those details in between. And by doing that, then you find you can really kind of knock back those details a little bit more, sort of underneath the surface of the pebble. That's how it looks really. Because when we add the shine or the top layers on there, that will really sink back all those initial washes. And again, we're going to work in very light tones to begin with and gradually get darker as we go along. So really, it's all about making that pebble look grounded, you know what I mean? So with like an authentic looking shadow underneath. And that shadow, even around on the pebble rather than just underneath it, which we're going to add in a bit, is really going to show the shape and the form. Adding the lights on the top as well. So what you got to think about the way the light's hitting the pebble as well. Is it coming from the top left, the top right, the middle? I don't know. So you got to look at this. And this obviously is coming from, let's say on the clock face, you're looking more from, say, 2 o'clock direction, heading down and hitting that pebble, isn't it? Creating the cast shadow, which I'm painting now, underneath the bottom of the pebble. So with this, you got to take your time. You can use a little bit of white paint over the top, but you can tint that white paint down with some colour as well. But when you're working on a shadow, you've got to try and think about as well, it's going to be darker as it goes underneath the stone and gradually gets lighter as it comes away from the stone. Did you know that I release a new video here on YouTube every single week? If you hit that subscribe button and the bell icon too, you'll get notified each time something new is published here. In the same vein, let's have a quick look at some algae covered concrete for our 5th painting texture. Now, lots of scumbling and random marks to create a very varied pattern across the surface is what's needed, because you're going to use the side of the brush as well. Now you can notice with this that I'm trying to not overload that brush too much with paint, because even though I'm using a cold pressed paper, there's a kind of a light texture on the paper. So kind of catching that texture of the paper using the side of a nearly dry brush is where I'm going to add the detail on here. Now again, the paint's going to dry a little bit lighter. So always start off with the lightest colour first, because at least that way around, you can gradually build up the colours as you go along. So you're going to get darker. Enrich those colours by changing the colour mixture a little bit as well. Obviously it depends on what you can see in your reference photograph, doesn't it? So if you find there's more reds or browns within the algae, then add those in as well. But add those in at the earlier stages. So then I'll soften things down that little bit as well, using a very large brush for me, which is a size 5. And then add even more detail over the top of that. Now you do have to kind of draw a limit sometimes for the amount of detail you add. but just make sure that you vary the pattern across the surface as you go along. And even by using a little bit of splattering, but you've got to mask off the area around it first, otherwise you're going to splatter all the other areas at the same time. But vary those colours when you use a splattering technique as well, and that will give you a nice kind of textured feel to algae covered concrete. Any of you that have painted dogs or horses may have had to add a collar or bridle. So for section number 6, we'll look at the techniques you will need to use to paint leather. So it's really about creating the texture that you can see without there being too much variation in the overall colour. Now, I mentioned colours, you find leather does vary in colour, doesn't it? So especially when it gets really old and very kind of chunky and bobbly and very rough looking. So you have to allow for that when you're working with kind of stippling techniques to create the leather feel. But also add the darkest layers on as well. I'll show you why in a minute. Now, I'm going to use masking fluid on this one. And instead, I'm taking the masking fluid off now to reveal the white of the paper. Now, the white of the paper, as we know, in this case, are the stitches. We've got to make sure that you remove all of that masking fluid first of all. Now, using a size 00 brush or a fine detail brush you've got in your kind of painting kit, shapen those stitches, so really create the different shapes that each one, very often, especially on old leather, tends to have. So some are curved, some are straight, some are darker and some are lighter. So allow for that as you're doing this. Okay, so also you can tone these down in places as well, or even brighten up by a little bit more white paint, so a little bit of watercolour white. Again, thinking about the overall shapes of these little individual stitches, just to kind of give them that extra touch. You could even add that little bit of colour over the top of the white as well. So I'll give you some ideas on how to paint leather. Are there any other textures that you would like to see me paint? Or are there any that you would like more detail on? Let me know in the comments below. Now when you're working on something like water, you have to think about the kind of reflection that you see from, in this case, the sky. And usually the water is sometimes a toned down mirror image of the sky itself, but look how wet the paper is. So you really want it very wet to begin with, and drop in your colours to begin with. I'm going to obviously go for blues in this case. Now, not all water is blue. It depends on the sky, remember. And also the reflection of the animal, in this case, this little bird, within the water itself. So you have to think about all these different things. So try to pre-plan when painting water by looking at the texture you can see within. Okay, it's a very softened texture, but again, reflected from the sky and the surrounding areas as well, very often. And also, if you're stood in front of the subject taking the photographs, you have to bear that in mind as well, because you might be reflected within that water surface. By pulling down in details like I'm doing here, that'll also give you a feeling of kind of shine and really like a level playing field, because water is flat, remember. It's sometimes mirror effect, but it's actually quite flat. So you have to have the horizontal lines and the vertical lines kind of make that stand out. So working wet and wet, as I mentioned, to create the vertical lines to suggest movement that you can see within the water. Now, because this little duckling is kind of swimming away, we can see we've got movement behind and underneath the bird as we go along. But add these in with a fine brush. You can always soften these down afterwards, can't you, if you wanted to. You can really do that. You can also use masking fluid as well to kind of mask off certain areas within the water before you even start any of this process. So use some thicker and thinner lines, varying the colour as you go along. But this will give you some general idea on how to paint the textures that we can see within water. I've got another video as well on painting water, so click on the card above it and it will line up in another tab for you to watch after this one is played, okay? Many bird paintings will involve trees, so we need to look at bark. So watercolour bark texture is our 8th focus. Now, like with the stones that we paint, it's the gaps which distinguish it as bark and not finished wood. So you can see within the gaps I'm painting here using my fine brush is by looking at the kind of darker areas you can see within those gaps and filling those areas in around those darkest parts. But then you can soften down areas around that and inside it as well if you wanted to. But try not to just kind of block it in completely, because otherwise it's just like a black hole, wouldn't it? So working with a scumbling technique and the wet in wet technique as well to create the initial texture, but do that initially so we can just have all that texture underneath the layers to build on top of as we go along. Vary the marks that you can see, And you can see within my painting here, I'm trying to think of the directions and the curves all the time. We don't want this wood looking flat, do we? Completely flattened out. So just bear that in mind when you're painting it. So one side is going to be lighter and the other side is obviously going to be darker. So think about the light source again, which way that light's hitting that wood. So focus on the finer details which show the splits and crevices within the wood. You know, so when you look at something like this, I'm trying to use stippling techniques and small dots. But then we start adding the white over the top. And again, I'm using watercolor white to really kind of pick out the kind of highlighted areas that we can see. But there's fewer kind of highlighted areas within the darker side of this wood. There are very few, because we need a dark side. And I'll also like to use a splattering technique again as well. Now, when you do this, make sure that you put paper around the painting. You don't want the splattering going everywhere, all over the place, even on your workstation as well. So try and avoid doing that. The only thing you're going to get messy is your finger when you're doing this. So you're going to load the brush with a variety of colors as you go along and use that little technique, as you can see on my white paper there, to kind of finish off how to create very detailed looking bark. Do you see that little card at the top? That's a link to a playlist of 9 videos all about painting wood and bark. Now, if you really want to have your bark look realistic, I think you'll find these videos really useful. For our 9th texture, we'll look at planing the wood, which has really completely different surface altogether, hasn't it? And needs different watercolor techniques to achieve it. So we need to focus on the direction of the grain by applying all the paint in this general direction. Because we have to remember that planed wood, well, it's gone through a machine, hasn't it, at the end of the day. So it's going to be a really smooth feel to it, really is. So do this by using the finest touches, hardly loading any paint on that brush sometimes to create those little kind of broken details. Now, do break your paint in places, you can see here. So little kind of skip marks, spaces, vary the thickness of the line at the same time as you go along. But replicate the patterns in the brush direction to create the grain as well as you do so. And then soften down, in this case, my very large size 5 brush. I know, that's a really big brush for me. By kind of adding the detail over the top of that, but also using a scumbling and even sometimes like a semi-dry brush technique by using the side of the brush to do that. See, then we can add those darkest layers on as well, can't we? But you gotta look at where it's really dark within the grains. But by adding those dark layers on, we can then really finish that wood off by creating like a sort of a 3D feel as well. You have to think about the overall shape of this. Yes, it may be planed, but you still gotta think about the light source and where the light is hitting the wood. Give it a try and just vary those brush techniques as you do so, okay? And also, don't forget the sizes of the brushes. And also, don't forget to change the colours every now and then as well, so it doesn't look all the same all the way through. Just slight variations. All these texture examples have been taken from a complete real-time video tutorials, so click on the card above to find out more about joining my online school. Finally, number 10 is lichen or lichen. Now, there are hundreds of different lichens, and we're just looking at one today. Now, they do vary greatly, don't forget, and this is just because there are hundreds of different ones, so your reference photograph is the key, okay? So you must really pinch into that reference photograph to be able to see the lichen and its textures, and the way it's also formed, the overall shape of individual parts of the lichen. But for this one in particular, I decided to use a little bit of watercolor white. Okay, I'll kind of correct that. Lots of watercolor white. And that's because I want to create like a glow to the lichen and the way that the brightness of the colour stands out. Because the thing is, once you've got white underneath and then you add a light colour like this kind of lime green colour I'm using now, then that really kind of makes it stand out. Having that white background on a very bright colour can really work very well. However, you've got to be careful because that white can move really, really easily. But then I've got to think about the overall shape and form of the lichen as well. Because we've got to think about the lighter colours and the detail we can see on top. So it's not just this one layer. We're now going to go in with like a slightly darker mix. And this is where we can look at individual shapes and kind of designs we can see within the lichen. And also there's little dark areas as well you find within it as well. But you might find in some of the lichen which you find on wood, for example, is that you see the texture of the wood in between in places. So you have to allow for things like that as well. And then I've gone down to size 00, but I'm varying the colours as I go along as well. So when you look by overlaying these colours I'm going to think about, now I've already got that lime colour on there, I'm now dulling that colour a little bit more by a little bit more blue within the yellow. And that way I'll get a deeper kind of tonal green feel to it. Then that means we can actually think about the overall shapes, the individual shapes within the lichen. So I'll give you some general idea on how I paint lichen. I really hope that you've learned some very useful techniques that you can use when you're working on your watercolour textures within your paintings. Now click on the Learn More picture at the bottom of the video to find out more about becoming a member. I'll see you in my next video to the right, which is all about the old wooden gate painting, which you saw within the section on how to paint rust.